All right, today we're going to do something kind of cool. We're cracking open the engine of an entire economy. We're going to look at the one blueprint economists use to figure out how a country creates all of its wealth. So let's dive right in. So let's just start with this huge question, right? How does a country actually create its wealth? I mean, how do you take all the people, all the stuff, all the tools, and turn them into, well, everything we see around us? Is there like a master blueprint for a whole economy?
Well, believe it or not, the answer is kind of yes. In the world of economics, it's called the production function. And that's the blueprint we're going to decode together today.
But, you know, before we can just jump into the blueprint, we've got to lay a foundation. We have to simplify things a little. To build a really clear model, economists set up some ground rules. Think of them as basic assumptions that let us see how the machine works without getting tangled up in all the messy real-world details.
So, what are these ground rules exactly? Let's take a look at the four main pillars that our entire model is going to rest on.
Okay, first up, we're pretending this is a closed economy. So no imports, no exports, just for simplicity's sake. Second, we're assuming the market is always balanced. You know, supply always equals demand. It's in equilibrium. Third, and this is a big one for later, we're going to say the level of technology isn't changing for now. And last, the core building blocks, what economists call the factors of production, they're also fixed. They're constant.
So I just mentioned factors of production, right? What are those? Well, for this blueprint, we're going to zoom in on the two big ones, labor and capital. Basically, the people doing the work and the tools they're using to get it done.
So on one side, you've got labor, which we just call L. Super straightforward, it's the workforce. On the other side, you have capital, and we use the letter K for that. And I know what you're thinking, why K? Why not C for capital? Well, it's a little quirk of economics. C was already taken for consumption. So K is our stand-in for all the tools, the machines, the factories, all that good stuff.
And hey, remember those ground rules we just set? This is where they kick in. For this model, we're assuming the amount of both labor and capital is fixed. It's not changing. And the way we show that in the math is by putting a little bar over the letter. So when you see L bar or K bar, it just means we're dealing with a set, constant amount of workers and machines.
Okay, our foundation is laid, the ground rules are set, now it's time for the good part. Let's decode the actual formula at the heart of this whole blueprint.
You can really think of the production function as like a recipe for the entire economy. It's the instructions that tell you exactly how to combine your ingredients, your capital, and your labor to cook up the final product, which is your country's total output.
And here it is, the formula itself. Y equals F of KL. Let's break that down real quick. Y is your total output. Just think of it as the country's GDP. K and L, well, we just covered those. That's your capital and labor. So what's the F? The F is the function. It's the technology, the knowledge, the secret sauce. It's what determines how efficiently you can turn your K and L into Y. And even though we've assumed it's fixed for now, trust me, that F is where all the magic happens.
So this blueprint is awesome for describing an economy that's just static, right? Fixed. But what if we could start changing things? What if we could actually add more workers or build more factories? What happens to our total output then?
Well, answering that question gets us into this really cool idea called returns to scale. And it's all about how efficiently an economy grows when you start adding more ingredients.
So let's ask a really simple question to get our heads around this. If we take our whole economy and we double everything, we double our labor, we double our capital, do we get exactly double the output? Or does something else happen?
Turns out there are really only three ways this can go. Look at that first row. If you double your inputs and your output exactly doubles, that's what we call constant returns to scale. Makes sense, right? Now, what if you double the inputs and you get more than double the output? That's awesome. That's increasing returns to scale. And finally, if you double your inputs and your output grows, but by less than double, that's decreasing returns to scale.
Let's actually visualize this first one, constant returns to scale. Here, the relationship is just perfectly proportional. If you scale up your inputs by any amount, let's call that amount Z, your output goes up by that exact same amount, Z. So 10% more inputs, 10% more output. Pretty simple. And honestly, this is the assumption economists often make for a whole economy.
But then you have this situation, increasing returns to scale. This is where things get really efficient. You double your inputs and you get more than double the output. Why would this happen? Well, think about specialization. A massive assembly line is way more efficient than a tiny workshop because everyone can specialize in one small task. Getting bigger makes you better.
And last up, we have decreasing returns to scale.
Now, this is super important. It doesn't mean your output is shrinking. Oh no, it's still growing. It just means that as you add more, you get less of a boost each time. If you double your inputs, your output might only grow by, say, 80%. This can happen when a business gets so big and bureaucratic that it just becomes harder to manage everything effectively.
Okay, so we've got our inputs, our function, our returns to scale. We've built this whole theoretical model, but let's get real for a second. Why does this simple blueprint actually matter? What does it tell us about the real world?
Because at the end of the day, it's so much more than just a formula on a screen. This blueprint is the fundamental lens that helps us see how an economy actually works. It's the basis for understanding productivity, for thinking about long-term growth, and even for analyzing how different government policies might play out. It's the thing that connects a country's raw resources to its actual wealth.
Yeah, this quote here really nails it. Economists aren't always obsessed with the nitty-gritty of how a car is built. What they really want to understand are the results of that process. How does that relationship between our workers and our tools, our factors of production, and the final output actually shake out? How does it all translate into the life we get to live?
And that brings us to a final, pretty powerful thought. Remember how we started all this? We made a huge assumption that capital and labor are fixed, and we also fixed that F variable, technology. So, let me leave you with this question. If a country can't just snap its fingers and get more workers or build more factories, what's left? What's the most powerful way for its economy to really grow? Something to think about. Thanks for tuning in.